Hey everyone, today I want to talk about boundaries. One of the most common sentiments that we have about life is that it is unfair. Life gives all of us with a unique set of skills and abilities, as well as a unique set of problems and obstacles to overcome. Limits and boundaries are enforced upon us, in most cases, before we are even born. Sometimes, even though it may seem like there are no limits or boundaries present, simply the nature of the knowledge that we want to acquire can act as a hurdle. Sometimes, simply our nature of observation, the way we see, can act as a hurdle. So to demonstrate that, let's do this for a second. So I want everyone to close their eyes. Okay, just for a second, don't worry. This isn't one of those tricks where you open your eyes and your wallets have disappeared. But so just close your eyes for a second. Okay, right now you can see approximately nothing. Your eyes are closed and that acts as a hurdle. All you can see is darkness and a few spots of light that disappear when you try to focus. Now open your eyes and look around you. Look at me, look at your friends, look at this hall. You're able to see a few meters around you, but let's say we want to see more. So let's imagine that this hall is gone. Let's imagine that the school is gone. Some people are really happy at that prospect. Let's imagine that this hall and the school is gone. We are standing in the middle of a wide open field. Right now, we can see around 20 kilometers around us. It's a pretty big jump, isn't it? But what if we want to see even more? What if we want to see more than that? Well, then we're going to have to go a little bit higher up, all the way up to the top of Mount Everest. Let's say we're at the top of Mount Everest, miles up in the sky. Thankfully, it's a good day with good weather, which means that firstly, we won't be freezing to death, and secondly, there are no clouds, which means we can see around 340 kilometers around us. But what if we still want to see more? What if we still want to see more? You know, 20 kilometers, 340 kilometers, not enough for us. Well, then we'll have to look up, all the way up to the Andromeda Galaxy. The Andromeda Galaxy, the closest galaxy to ours, is over 2.5 million light years away. What that means is that light, the fastest thing in existence, takes 2.5 million years to travel between the two. And by extension, what that means is this image of Andromeda that we see right now is technically a peek into the past. It's an image of what Andromeda looked like 2.5 million years ago. But what if we still want to see more? After all, human spirit has always been curious, always been thirsty for knowledge. So how do we see more? Because again, our observation is limited by our own capabilities. Human observation has always been limited by human capabilities. So what do scientists do when they want to see beyond what they can observe? And that brings us to one of the biggest questions in cosmology today. And that is the question of dark matter. Before we talk about what is dark matter, it is important to realize why dark matter is something worth studying. Now, as this graph shows us with data taken from NASA, dark matter consists almost 23% of the known universe's volume. Everything that we see around us, planets, galaxies, stars, dust, comets, asteroids, everything forms about less than 5% of that. And from those 5%, a significant percentage, almost 4%, is simply free hydrogen and helium. Everything that you see around us, this entire universe that we're able to see, most of it falls in that tiny little 1%. And therefore, it's important to study dark matter because it forms up a very, very significant, substantial chunk of our universe. So what is dark matter? In technical terms, dark matter is matter with which the electromagnetic spectrum does not interact. Now, that sounds a bit technical, so let's break it down. Why are you able to see me right now? Why am I able to see any of you? It's because light from all these sources is bouncing off of me, going into your eyes, and forming an image of me in your retina. I'm, of course, able to see you guys for the very same reasons. Light is hitting you guys, bouncing off of you, entering my retinas, and I'm able to see an image of you. With dark matter, it's almost as if the light just passes through, does not interact at all. And not just light, every other thing that we use to detect from the electromagnetic spectrum, radio waves, infrared waves, gamma rays, they all simply do not react with this type of matter. But we know that exists, not because we've seen it, but because it has to. calculations of how fast stars move, how fast galaxies move, how particles behave, and how much radiation is present at any point in the background tell us that the universe is far, far heavier than it seems to be. Now, imagine a box, if you will, okay? You try to pick up this box, and it's extremely, extremely heavy. But you open the box, and all you see are feathers. You know something is missing, right? And this is what scientists have been dealing with. Imagine you blow up this box to an extremely, extremely, extremely large scale. We'll realize that this is the kind of dilemma that scientists are facing today. But this process of opening the box, looking at the box, and realizing that what is inside is not matching up is what we do, how we observe when we cannot really observe. We infer. So let's talk about inferences for a while. Right now, in my hands, I have an apple. Okay? Now, I know that an apple is a fruit. This object in my hand is an apple, and therefore, I have in my hands a fruit. I know that objects with mass fall, and this object in my hand, of course, has mass, and therefore, it too will, after a point, fall. We know that the universe is this heavy, but there simply isn't enough matter in it for it to be this heavy. And that tells us that there's something missing. And that is how what scientists do. They infer. They look at ideas which are based on other ideas which are considered fundamental, which are considered true. And that is what we like to call proof by infinite regress. Ideas are considered true because they are based on another set of ideas which are considered true, which are again based on another set of ideas which are considered true. Turtles All the Way Down is a popular visualization of this idea, with roots from mythological stories from all around the world, which basically state that the entire world is balanced on top of a giant turtle. This idea asks the fundamental question, that if the entire world is on top of this turtle, then where is this turtle? What is the turtle standing on? And the answer that this idea gives us is that the turtle is standing on top of another turtle, which is standing on top of another turtle, which is again standing on top of another turtle. And this represents the belief that our world is essentially made up of beliefs, is made up of ideas that are based on certain fundamental principles, which themselves are based on more fundamental principles. And of course, because our idea of observation, because our idea of observation and seeing depends on the electromagnetic spectrum as a whole, dark matter continues to be elusive for all of us. Dark matter continues to evade our vision. And if we ever do come to a conclusion about what the nature of dark matter is, how would we know that it is true? Because we're depending more on inferences rather than observations here, there are so many areas that remain to be unseen. And with so many areas that remain to be unseen, there's always the possibility of a contradicting observation. And this possibility always exists, no matter what, in every situation. Even in our day-to-day life, can any of us ever claim to know the full picture? Of course not. And that is what philosophers like to call the underdetermination of scientific theory. In science, when we talk about any theory which has been put forward, any phenomena that we see, this theory states that there can never truly be enough sufficient evidence to say whether it is right or wrong. Now, underdetermined theories are not necessarily wrong. It's just that it's difficult to know if they are right. For example, let's say I go to the market. I have $10 with me. I know that apples cost $1 and oranges cost $2. Now, I can eliminate some possibilities, right? That I couldn't have bought 20 oranges or 20 apples, unless, of course, the shopkeeper really likes me. So you can eliminate some possibilities, but with only this limited information, it's difficult to know what exact combination has been purchased, right? There's always this underlying uncertainty. And everyone from the ancient Greeks to modern philosophers like René Descartes have discussed this idea of an underlying uncertainty in the observations that we make. But what does this have to do with us? This uncertainty, this underdetermination and dark matter. What do one of the biggest questions in cosmology today and millennia withstanding philosophy have to do with you and I? Well, the answer, quite anticlimactically, lies inwards. It lies in the way we think about others and ourselves. It lies in the conclusions, the boundaries that we have on others and ourselves. It lies in the observations that we make about others, and the conclusions that we reach to based on what we think is true. So let's talk about, let's sort of come back to this idea of boundaries as a whole. In societies, communities, families worldwide, we've seen this. We see limits and boundaries being imposed on people simply because of what we think is right, because of what we've observed about them and the idea that we have come up about them. Now, a convict with a history of violent crime may not necessarily be fit for exoneration under this theory of underdeterminism. It just simply states that there is a possibility for rehabilitation. A child with consistently poor test scores may not necessarily ace his upcoming test, but there is a possibility for improvement, and if this possibility always exists, then how can we come to a proper conclusion, a final judgment on the child's capabilities or aptitude? Now, this is how it's affecting basically all of us, because we see that in societies, in communities, families worldwide, this uncertainty being imposed on others on the basis of these preconceived notions. Now, in most cases, having preconceived notions is not an issue. They're simply oversimplifications made by our mind to make life simpler for us. Issues only start to arise when we start limiting others or ourselves on the basis of these preconceived notions. In environments around the world, we see these boundaries being put on individuals. A history of doctors in your family doesn't mean the only thing your child is capable of becoming or should become is a doctor. A history of crime associated with a community doesn't mean that every member has criminal tendencies or should be treated with mistrust in the future. If a multitude of factors always affects any situation, then how can we ever know if something is true? And if we do not know if it is completely 100% true, then is it truly right to place limits or boundaries on the basis of that information on others? So in any sort of situation, we know that there is uncertainty. We know that we cannot always know for sure. We know that we cannot always see or observe and know that what we see or observe is true. Then rather than letting this uncertainty act as a limit, it should be a sign of the multitude of opportunities that are available to all of us. In environments like these, in situations like these, sometimes it is okay to give others the benefit of the doubt and accept this uncertainty. So when we look up and we look around, and we see this uncertainty, and we realize the lack of our ability to always know for sure, we take one step closer to truly understanding and towards truly giving others and ourselves a chance to rise. Thank you very much.